you in our lives. We want to let you have your way. This convention was organized for you. Gentle, loving, Holy Spirit, Father of mercy and grace, everlasting God, we welcome you. Spirit of truth, Spirit of might, Spirit of counsel, the God who teaches us how to be profitable, the Lord who shows us by the way that we should go. We gather in your name and we give you preeminence. We give you absolute glory and ultimate praise. We call you worthy and wonderful, mighty and awesome, glorious Jesus. Are you ready for the palace, queens? Are you ready for the palace? You know, Joseph woke up as a prisoner and he walked to be the prime minister, the governor of the day. You know, God will promote you for sure in this convention. You better put yourself ready for the palace. Hallelujah. Tell somebody you're welcome. Pastor Esther welcomes you to this meeting. Tell somebody you're welcome. Come on, give somebody a high five. Tell them you're welcome in Jesus' name. It's nice to see you. Tell them they are looking good. Tell them that you love them with the love of the Lord. It could be the only love that they received this month. Tell them that you love them. Hallelujah. With the joy of the Lord, help me to bring on the pulpit our own mommy, Pastor Dr. Esther Obasike. You're welcome, mommy, and we love you. Amen.
Queens, put your hands together for the Lord. 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 Jab your hands together for the Lord. Jab your hands together for the Lord. Jab your hands together for the Lord. Amen. Amen. You're welcome to the palace. There is a spiritual relocation this weekend. You better believe it. I say you better believe it. There is a serious spiritual shift. God is adding 2 to 2, but it's not 4. 2 plus 2 for God is becoming a billion in your life. Hallelujah. We welcome you to the second day of this convention. The excitement in the city is so much. Every nook and corner you enter, they are talking about the convention. Every nook and corner, people are saying, there is something happening in Nyayo Stadium. And you know, I went out with the woman of God today, and we could not, the joy was too much. And we were saying to each other, when the hand of the Lord is in a thing, when the signature of God is in a thing, I tell you, that check cannot bounce. And we were asking ourselves, what is going to happen next year, convention? Because already God has told me this morning, the theme of convention July 2015 I'm going to be giving you the theme of July 2015 tomorrow. This is God that has gone ahead of us. He said that many people have rode upon our heads. We have passed through waters. Men have marched on us. Women have marched on us. People have spat on us. But he said as they did it, we ended up in a wealthy place. That's what the scripture says. He said we ended up in a wealthy place. Whatever you are going through in your life now, thank God. That's the highway to the wealthy place. And so this evening, we want to look at something in 2 minutes. Then we bring up the man of God to the podium. Whenever you sit like a queen. I've told you, queens sit organized. When you talk like a queen. I went to the airport with one of my spiritual children to pick up Reverend Hope. And I was so hungry. Because we were walking, I think a day before that day, and we walked from morning around 7 a.m., 8 a.m. I started work. And we finished the work in the office and carried some work home. And this, my daughter, followed me home. Getting home, we were in my sitting room doing the work together till 5 a.m. the following day. And so, I think when we went to pick Reverend Hope, we were together, hunger was teaching me a lesson at the airport. And on the way, I said, let me pick up something and eat. So I picked up some food, a chicken, and I wanted to eat. Something told me, you remember you told the women don't eat on the street. I said, Jehovah, hunger has no identification here. I had to struggle to find a way to put food in my mouth so that nobody will see me. And she told me, Mom, you better not eat because I won't be shocked that as soon as we step into the airport, somebody will say, Mommy. I say, now, Mommy, hunger is dealing with Mommy. Do you know that as soon as we step into arrival, the next thing I had, hey, Mommy. Somebody who came to see somebody had sighted me. And we just put the chicken this way. When you become a queen, your life becomes a standard and a reference point. You become a role model. Every woman seated here is a role model. And soon I will read about you in the newspaper in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Proverbs 31. Proverbs 31, verse 10. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. Who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is far above rubies. Her worth, what she wants, her value, is far above diamond, above rubies, above shillings, above pound sterling, above dollars, whatever we call them. The price of this woman is so expensive. But when you go down, you begin to hear other things about this woman. One woman, she negotiates about a property. She buys it, like I said yesterday, without committee. The Bible said that the cloth she was wearing was linen. That's why tomorrow, even if you did not buy the uniform, sit next to the fellow with uniform. Because fire begets fire. I've been told over 500 women bought uniform. So if you come and for one reason or the other you couldn't buy, make sure you are seated next to someone who bought. Because next year you will not only buy, you will buy for other people. This woman will look at property and buy. The Bible said that her works were praising her at the gates. In other words, before she arrives in an occasion, her works are speaking on her behalf. Her husband is known by her, not the other way around. I want to believe that those of you that are stranded in life and you are looking for who to marry because you need economic deliverance, after this meeting, men shall be looking for you. 10 men will be looking for you. You know, the scripture says that a time will come when 7 women will take hold of a man and say, we just want to answer Mrs. So, marry us. It will never come to pass in this place. Your case will not be a case of asking one man. You don't even need to know my parents. You don't need to know where I work. Just allow me to put your surname, your name, on my name. That's what the scripture says. 7 women, we hold one man. And that's what is going on today. People who are married are struggling with the other 6 women, holding their husbands. But for queens, who does not want to marry a queen? For you, 7 men, if you are not yet married, we'll be writing application for marriage. And if you're married, like I told you before, you will be the kind of wife that when your husband wakes up, he first composes a song with your name. Whether the song has key or not, he sees you lying down on the bed. He stands by the corner, says, so this is my wife, Jehovah, eh? Jehovah, eh? Say, who can find such a woman? You are expensive. And so today, to lead us into the palace of Persa and economic empowerment is none other than a man of God that we met. I met him for the first time in a women meeting of JCC. And we started ministering together that day, and eventually I invited him to our retreat. This man came to our women's prayer retreat and blew our minds. After he blew our minds, we invited him for couples forum. I think 3 weeks ago. Was it 3 weeks ago you came to speak to our married people? Or two Saturdays ago. He came there, the couple. The only thing I missed is that my husband was not around. Every couple came with their, every husband came with their wives. When I arrive alone because daddy was out of the country. And now the man told every man to carry their wives on the lap, irrespective of your kilogram and pounds. And I sat at the table where I was because I had nobody, but I was on the lap of the Holy Spirit. I just sat there. And I was monitoring the way he carried his wife. He just told me that the wife couldn't come because she couldn't get permission from work. And I was watching them. And I saw the way the wife was touching the ear. Hey, touching the head. That's not the wife, eh? I said, this is another level. You will think they met in that meeting that day. Dr. Kianju Nganga holds a Doctor of Philosophy degree in Project Planning and Management from the University of Nairobi and a Master's of Art degree in Project Planning and Management from the same university. He did his undergraduate studies at JKU-AT. In addition to being the lead consultant at Shape Africa and a lecturer at the University of Nairobi, Dr. Nganga is a leading brand in motivational speaking and training, both in the private and public sectors, as well as non-governmental organizations and learning institutions across Africa. He is happily married to Mercy. I am a testimony. And that's my own word. An ICT professional, and they've been blessed with 1 daughter, Ivy, and 1 son, Zeke. Dr. Kianji has also authored the formation of a county government in Kenya, Paradigm Shift in Parenting and Ultimate Success. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the Lord as we welcome to the podium Dr. Kianji Nganga. God bless you as you welcome the man of God.
Wow, wow, wow. Thank you so much. Thank you. You want us to read the verse before you sit? All right, Jeremiah 17, verse 5. Wow. Are you there? Jeremiah 17, verse 5. Can we read together? Are you there? This is what the Lord says, cursed is the one who trusts in man, who depends on flesh for his strength, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. He will be like a bush in the wasteland. He will not see his prosperity when it comes. He will dwell in the parched places of the desert, in a salt land where no one lives. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. He will be like a tree planted by the water that sets out its roots by the stream. He does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. The heart, yeah, let's read there. Can we just read Isaiah 30, please? Don't get tired. Isaiah 30, verse 1 to 3. Are you there? Isaiah 30, verse 1 to 3. Are you ready? One, two, go. Woe to the obstinate children, declares the Lord, to those who carry out plans that are not mine, forming an alliance but not by my spirit, heaping sin upon sin, who go down to Egypt without consulting me, who look for help to Pharaoh's protection, to Egypt's shade for refuge, but Pharaoh's protection will be to your shame, Egypt's shade will bring you disgrace. Isaiah 31, verse 1 to 3. It is very similar to Isaiah 30, almost the same scripture. Look at that, verse 1 to 3. One to go. Woe to those who go down to Egypt for help, who rely on horses, who trust in the multitude of their chariots and in the great strength of the horseman, but do not look to the Holy One of Israel or seek help from the Lord. Yet he is too can bring disaster. He does not take back his words. He will rise up against the house of the wicked, against to help evildoers. But the Egyptians are men and not God. Before we sit, let me just say this. Every time the Israelites went to Egypt for help, there was disaster. And Isaiah in particular repeated times two, that woe to those who go to Egypt for help. For the Egyptians are men and not God. Woe to the ladies who look for men for help. For these men are not God. God does not need the help of a man to make you a billionaire. Can we pray? Our gracious Lord, we thank you this afternoon for the honor, the privilege to be your children. We submit your authority to the teaching of the scriptures, even to learn and to hear from you. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We may be seated. You're splendid in every way. You look awesome and beautiful. And mom, like Pastor Esther, happened once in a lifetime. I haven't seen this kind of a gathering so splendid during the day. You know, we had a big gathering at JCC at night. For people to leave their places of work, that means there is something serious here. I think I congratulate you. This is amazing. Perhaps before I come back to scriptures, let me just say this. The whole topic about wealth, I've given it a lot of thought. And a few things struck my attention. First, there are 2,000 verses in the Bible that speak about wealth. Out of the 38 parables that Jesus taught, 16 of them are about money. Jesus talked about money 5 times more than heaven and hell combined. It's an amazing thing. I've always thought, is there any human being on this planet who'd prefer to enter Guinness Book of Record because of being failure number one? Such that when she is buried, this will be the poorest dude that ever appeared in Nairobi, the dirtiest girl in city, the one who had the highest number of enemies, the person who was always a disgrace to everyone until Guinness Book of Record gets your name as failure number one. Never once have I ever met anyone who is proud of failure. The question before us, how come an exceptionally few people succeed in whichever field of endeavor, in ministry, in sports, in business, in career, in professions? Every time you meet two people side by side, one is keeping a hotel, one succeed, one fails. Two people are doing saloon, one succeeds in beauty, the other one fails. Two people are doing matatu, one adds up with thousands of them, thousands of trucks, 26-wheeler, and the other person can never make it to the second truck. What is the line between the two? And they all have the same desire, even if they are not in an environment that is so conducive. Even before I read for you the scriptures that I have for us today, I realize there are three characteristics about people who achieve economic breakthroughs. First of all, they believe in themselves. They believe they are endowed with the seeds of greatness. They believe they are designed for accomplishment, engineered for success, and designed for destiny. They have this conviction, whichever place you position them, they'll always emerge as the top people. Secondly, they know themselves. They never pretend to be someone else. They identify their mission and they live by it. They stick and they identify and stick that God-given destiny. And thirdly, they know what they want. They not only know who they are, but they know what they want. They have a clear vision of their destiny. A boy who was 13 years old was told by one of his doctors he'll never live to realize his 16th birthday. The father called him because he used to be a top student in the line of academics. And he told him, son, you have the brains, but your body fails you. Not unless and until you do something about your body, you'll never live to realize your dreams in life. Hearkening to the father's advice, he began going for body exercises regularly, embarking on the right nutrition, and contrary to the doctor's prediction, he not only outlived the age of 16, but in the early 20s, he joined one of the leading boxing clubs, and he was a pro boxer. Later on in life, he decided to pursue a career in politics. He thrived so well, so much, so that on 20th of January, 1901, he was declared the U.S. president, and he continued for two terms. One day, I was speaking like I'm speaking to you on a clear afternoon. Someone decided to shoot him down. The bullet, however, missed the target, his heart, and went to the right outside of the ribs, broke several ribs, and he bled profusely. The amazing thing about this man, President Theodore Roosevelt, he continued delivering his speech for the next 1 hour while still bleeding. When he was done, he said, I'm through with my speech. Now you can take me to hospital. I'm through with my mission. I decided to hold on. Several years ago, a young man in Kenya was crippled by polio. He got a chance to join Study One at the age of 20. 20 years of age, class one pupil. But Reverend Jackson Kosgei did not look at what he didn't have. He looked at what he did have. He saw that as an opportunity, fast track his story. He went to KU and did a degree in linguistics, despite the fact that he got a chance to go to school at the age of 20. 8 years back, a young man visited our country by name Nick Vujic, with no hands and no legs. Despite his handicap, Nick Vujic has visited about 23 countries preaching and doing motivational talks. He's a computer wizard. He's a swimming pro, and I'm suspicious 50% of this live audience cannot swim with two hands and two legs. Look, let's establish some five principles from the Bible about money, and then I'll give you my message. This is just for foundation. Is that okay? Just some five principles. Number one, it is our Father's intention to give us wealth. It is God's desire to give us money. Please open with me, 1 Chronicles 29:12. We're going to read together. We have to establish some principles. 1 Chronicles 29:12. Are you there? I'll wait for you. We need to get some clear principles. So money is a blessing. Money is not a curse. Are you there? 1 Chronicles 29:12 together. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Just say this after me. Wealth and honor come from you, O Lord. How many here can remember Psalms 23 verse 1? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. How many of us here can remember Galatians 3:13? He became a curse that we might become blessed of God. Poverty is a curse, and we need to call it by its name. Jesus was poor only in one instance, and this is at the cross, no other place. I hear a lot of Christians saying, Abraham was blessed with spiritual blessings. Wrong. He was blessed literally, materially. The Bible says cattle, goats, silver, and gold, men servant and maiden servant. He was blessed materially. That's the language the world understands. Principle number two. It is God who gives us power to make wealth. How many can quote for us Deuteronomy 8:18? It is God who gives us power to make wealth. Deuteronomy 8:18? Anyone who can remember? For it is he who gives us the power to make wealth. Principle number three, and this is important in a queen's meeting. Relying on others for your upkeep is a curse. And that is what I was reading with you. Relying on others for your upkeep is a curse. I read with you Jeremiah chapter 17, verse number 5. There are a lot of ladies in this great city of Nairobi who look forward to marrying a wealthy man. And I'm here to tell you, children of God, that is looking for a curse. Jeremiah 17, 5, cursed is the man whose trust is in another man. Verse 7, but blessed is the man whose trust is in the Lord. God never intended your blessings to come through someone else. Yes, we can co-work together, we can work under someone's anointing, but God knows you by your name. He doesn't need the help of anyone to bless you. Principle number four, God's wealth is infinite. You cannot exhaust God's wealth. Psalms 24, anyone who can remember? The earth is the Lord's and the fullness, their love. Everything belongs to our God. Principle number five and the last one. We are joint heirs with Christ. Who can read for us Romans 8:17? Romans 8:17. We are joint heirs with Christ. Anyone who can read for us? Romans 8:17. Yes. Yeah, come. What is the name of the queen? Queen Grace. Ray. Queen Ray knows how to open the Bible. Good.
Amen. Queen Ray is reading. Romans 8:17 says, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Amen.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Now, there's a difference between equal heirs and joint heirs. When you equally own a property, you own 50%. That's equal heirs. Joint heirs means everything you have belongs to Christ. Everything he has belongs to you. You are joint heirs. You own everything equally. You're not equal heirs. You are joint heirs, meaning you don't own the blouse you're wearing. They belong to Christ. You jointly own it. But everything he has also belongs to you. Now, I think I want to speak to you now. We are just establishing some biblical principles. The real question are not the issues I've talked with you. Most of you know those principles and they can memorize them inside out. You've known them since Sunday school days. The question before us, if it is God's will for us to be wealthy, if we are joint heirs with Christ, if it is his desire for us to be blessed, how come the overwhelming majority of believers leave this planet struggling without tapping into the infinite source? The real question before us, how come many of us do not walk in that world? That's the question I want us to answer. Is that okay? I will share with us 10 things that prevent us from tapping into the infinite source. Why are we not able to get into that place where we do not worry about provisions, where we are not bothered, and we just enjoy abundant living? Why don't we reach there? Number one, the first reason why we don't reach there, lacking a value system. call it indiscipline, in simple terms, indiscipline. And there are various types of indisciplines that I have seen with a lot of believers. May I begin by saying, Jesus lived a disciplined life. In your own devotional time, check Mark chapter 1 verse 35. And the Bible says, a great while before day, Jesus rose up, went to a solitary place, and there he prayed. He had a particular discipline. Every single day of his life, he had a discipline of prayer. He never compromised, whether it was snowy, whether it was rainy, the way we do it in Nairobi. When it's July, the people in church are fewer. When it's raining, we are fewer in church, but we still go to work. But early in the morning, some Bible theologians estimate that to be 3 in the morning. Now, what are some of the disciplines we lack? First, we lack the discipline of work. In plain language, we are lazy people. That's not popular. Paul says he used to work day and night. And if you want, maybe you can read during your own time, 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 7 to 8. He used to work night and day. He was so mad with the people who didn't work, he said they should not eat, they should die. That's the Apostle Paul's view about laziness. The Bible teaches in Proverbs 10 verse 4 that if you are lazy, you will surely become poor. But if you are hardworking, you will make wealth. Proverbs 6, 10. A lazy, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of hand. So I see some of us who are in insurance and marketing, and you're supposed to visit 10 people in a specific day. You decide 10 o'clock to go for a social coffee. 1 o'clock, you read newspaper, the Star, the magazines in town. By 5 o'clock, you've only seen one client. And then you come to church for financial breakthrough. You need a thorough beating. I'm serious with you. There is no shortcut to hard work. Work is the price we pay to travel the highway of success. If you're waiting for anything to turn up, you'll turn up your own shirt sleeves. No one ever drowned in his own sweat. The only place in the world where success comes before work is in the dictionary. Work is a blessing. Let me remind you in the creation story. Adam was given by God work long before the curse. The curse comes in chapter 3. But we see God giving work right in chapter 2. And even in chapter 1 verse 27, go multiply, reproduce. All along, our God was at work. For how many days did he work in the creation story? 6 days. On the 7th day, he rested. So in God's diary, you're supposed to work for 6 days, not Monday to Friday. Jesus said, I'm at work, and my Father is at work. God's calendar demands you work for 6 good days. Anything below that, you're not performing optimally. Lazy dudes, stop it. By the way, it's a command. Let me show you. The Bible says it's a command. Just look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 7. If you didn't know it's a command to work, let me just show you. Sorry, 2 Thessalonians, sorry. 2 Thessalonians 3, 6. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we command you, sisters, to keep away from every idle sister. Are you there? Look at your Bible. And then Paul says, part B of verse 8, part B of verse 8. On the contrary, we worked night and day, laboring and toiling. That's the apostle who wrote 13 books in the Bible. If you like, that's the greatest apostle in the scriptures. He worked with his own hands. What excuse do you have? How many books have you written? Paul wrote 13 of them in the Bible. How many have you written? Laziness. Look, what do you do? What's your profession, my sister? Marketing. Have you done a book in marketing? 2,000 years ago, without a computer to help him write and Google search, he wrote books. What a shame if you can't. No typewriter, no computer. What do you do? Business. What business? Sorry? Sell clothes. Have you tried to document about designer clothes? Paul did it 2,000 years ago. Because he was anointed. No, he was hardworking. He tells Timothy, you know what? You have received an anointing by the laying of hands, but you have to show yourself a workman approved by God. by studying the scriptures. There is some work for you, Timothy. There is God's part. Yes, the gift comes from God. There is your part, Timothy. You're going to work. There's no shortcut to work. Jesus said, I repeat, I am at work and my Father is at work. Another discipline we lack. For those who are in business, you receive some money from a bank and you digress the project funds to some other projects. So you cannot service the facility. That's lack of discipline. John C. Maxwell, a motivational speaker, a preacher, a man of God, says that, I quote, successful people make important decisions early on in their lives, and then they manage those decisions for the rest of their lives. Let me say it one more time. Successful people make important decisions early on in their lives, and then they manage those decisions for the rest of their lives. Another discipline we lack is the discipline of giving. Hear me, children of God. If you don't give, you won't receive, period. You can work 24 hours. If you don't learn how to release, these principles work even for unbelievers. It's like the law of gravity. You know, Jesus taught in Matthew 6:24, store up treasures where thieves cannot break into and moths cannot eat. In ancient Palestine, the pharaohs of Egypt used to be buried together with their gold and silver. And let me shock you, together with their male servants and maiden servants alive. They used to be buried alive. So that when Pharaoh, who believed in reincarnation, when he wakes up on the other side, he wakes up together with his servants. Conscious of this reasoning, Jesus spoke and said, those pyramids, moths can eat and these can break into. Years after Jesus spoke that, the pyramids of Egypt, one by one, were vandalized. The only way to ensure you meet your treasure someday is investing in God's kingdom. If you do not have the discipline of giving, you cannot prosper. That's just a fact. We have to get these principles right. Don't come in here for prayers if you're not willing to obey these principles. It won't work for you. You must cultivate the discipline of giving. This is just a principle. What am I saying? If you discipline yourself to do what you ought to do, when you ought to do it, the day will eventually come when you'll be able to do what you want to do when you ought to do it. Develop some clear values. Let people know what you can from what you can't do. Let them know 8 to 5 is working hours. Don't compromise that in the name of catching up with another queen. After this message, you need to share it with other people. Do it after 5 o'clock. Do it on Sunday. Work is the foundation of all wisdom. Why are Christians not enjoying abundance? Number two, fear. Number two, fear. I'm going to say this. How many in this live audience are employed? Don't shy. If you're employed, lift up your hand. Anyone who is employed and he's here, don't shy. Lift up your hand. Anyone who is not doing her own business. You're working for a bank. You're working for a company. You're working for the government. You're working for Safaricom. You're working for anyone. For an individual business. Wow. Now hear me, daughters of God. That salary is a seed. You will never reach financial liberty through a salary. Impossible. That salary is a seed. You must take it and plan your transition. There must be a moment where you're exiting. And the only thing that holds you there, it is because of fear. I guarantee you this. You know all the scriptures. The challenge is implementing. You can quote for me, he has not given us the spirit of fear. You can sing better than me. But the spirit of power. Wow. And the spirit of love and sound mind. Fear enough. Through scriptures, God says, fear not. And some people estimate about 365 times. I've never tried to count. But here's a situation whereby we are held back by fear of uncertainties. Yet the Bible is explicit. We should walk by faith, not by sight. Some people will tell you, say things as they are. I say wrong. Say what you want to see. That's the language in the Bible. The Bible teaches us that he calls things which are not as though they are. So do not say the current situation. Yes, you're employed, but you want to do hotel industry. you want to go to Lukenya and put for us conference facilities. We are becoming very congested in Nairobi. Start speaking about that conference facility and tell us right now. There is a conference facility in Lukenya that I'm doing. It is 120 rooms. Yes. Don't wait for things to be clear. Say it even when it's not clear. Why? When you start speaking it, it forms mental pictures. As you work, you go to implement those mental images. We are born with two natural fears. The fear of falling and the fear of loud noises. Every other fear is acquired along the way. There's an uncle who told you you can't make it. There's someone who said you can't do it and you just buy it. Fear. In 1932, they completed the tallest building ever. For 50 years, there was not such a building. Today, of course, we have taller buildings. So here, the tallest is Burj Khalifa, Dubai. But in those days, the builders would look at the ground floor, paranoid over the height. They would panic and collapse, fall and die. One structural engineer realized they're losing too many lives. He suggested they put up a net system just in case they tip over. They will fall on the net and they are going to pick them up. Guess what? As soon as the net was put up, none of them ever fell again. What used to make them fall? Fear. I read of a story of some three boys. They were playing around a railway line. They were blindfolding each other. At some point, a train was approaching at a terrific speed. The train, however, never ran over the boy but passed on a different track. The two boys who thought they were just playing around, they were shocked. When they came to untie this boy, never touched by the train, the boy was already dead. The boy knew what would happen if he was crushed by a moving train, and he couldn't wait for it. Fear. I read of a story of someone who was passing by a cemetery at night. Unfortunately, he fell in an empty graveyard. Now, when he fell in the graveyard, he struggled and struggled to get out and finally gave up. It was dark and cold. A couple of minutes later, someone was passing by and became a culprit of the same tragedy. He fell in the same graveyard but never noticed the older man. Then the guy who was there earlier along told the other person, hapa hutatoka, within a second, jamali kwa metoka. You know, if you are chased by fierce dogs, you jump fences you've never jumped. Is that so? I read of a story of someone who was passing by a cemetery, and Pastor Esther, you know, some places in Kenya, we are very superstitious, especially with graveyards. So he was passing by a cemetery, and behind him, he realized there were some three thugs following him, perhaps after his money, his mobile phone, I don't know. He decided to lie down on a footpath and wait for them. When they reached there, he only made one statement, and they all left in different directions. He said this, when I used to be alive, he never added anything else. And they all left in different directions. Fear. You know, when people drown in a lake or a sea or a swimming pool, they are never killed by the amount of water they drink. Scientifically and medically speaking, when the post-mortem is carried out on their dead bodies, it's been found out that their heart stopped beating because of fear. There's something wrong with fear. Most of the things we fear never happen. And someone said, the problem in fear is that you fear twice. You fear before it happens, and you fear after it happens. So my challenge for us, go sell that sugar. If somebody comments there are some stones and pebbles in it, smile like a banana, tell them you're not mumias, you are a distributor, period. Don't fear. Believe me, every person you see doing great things, deep down their heart, they have some fear. Courage is not the absence of fear. But it's the mastery of fear. Where you trust God's word, not because things are clear, but you just obey. Or you think it was very clear for Abraham as he was told to go to a land he didn't know, a land that was described flowing with milk and honey. Do you think it was clear? It was never clear. So you will not do that enterprise, you not venture into that industry if things are going to be clear. So by the time I finish this sermon, I would like somebody to go to Turkana and start distributing oil. Don't wait for everything to be clear. Work backwards. Find out the licenses you need. I would like someone listening to us here to go back to Kitui and pick up the coals and take it to China. And we have some markets for it. You can see me after this. I would like someone who is listening to me here to stop selling vegetables and export to Russia. We are opening up the airline to USA. Start packing varroa and aubergines and papri and okra and runner beans and French beans and moshtu and sugar peas. Man, start packing and stop packing raw products. Today, we can sell avocados to Europe by waxing. Where we used to pay $2 per kilo, you can pay $0.3 by ship. You can do it by sea. You don't have to do it by air. But I have to continue talking about various businesses as we go through that, so that I can start building faith in you. But we need some oil magnet in this place. Who said oil belongs to the Arabs? How many here know that oil belongs to God? Is that so? And then some of you need to produce something better than oil. It is dirtifying the climate and help our cars move with something we do not know, better than electricity. Number three, the third thing that is preventing us to reach God's destiny, P-R-O-C-R-A-S-T-I-N-A-T-I-O-N. Ah, you are young people. Can you try it one more time? P-R-O-C-R-A-S-T-I-N-A-T-I-O-N. I'll give the first person the first gift. Procrastination. Okay, I'm going to give somebody a gift right now. Let's try to do. Can I request you to say something after me? And if you remember what you have said, I'll give you a gift. Let's try. Say this after me loud and clear enough. The gonna doers are the never doers. Small deeds done are better love than great deeds planned. It's easier to stay in action than to start an action. Beginning is halfway done. Great things are accomplished through tiny moves. But nothing is accomplished by standing still. Be not afraid of moving slowly. Be afraid of standing still. What I am to be, I am busy becoming right now by the choices that I am making. The first one to quote three statements out of seven, this book. Don't paraphrase, just quote three. You carry this book. Three statements out of seven. I'm saying just repeat what you said. Yes, yes, come. Some of you have this book. Yes. Just try three statements. Come, 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 come. Yeah. I think you came for fun in this church, isn't it?
Okay. I'll try. The first one I remember is the problem is not how slowly you're moving, but how slowly you're moving, but not moving at all. Better are the small plans that you've started than big plans that are just planned and nothing is being done about it.
Just come. You didn't quote any, but thank you so much. You came. All right. Thank you for coming. I say the first one, the gonna doers are the never doers. When I start that shop, it is gonna be a supermarket. When I start, my sister, Urijuagi, we have the genes of business. When I, but they never, those guys are called the gonna doers. The gonna doers are the never doers. Number two, small deeds done are better love than great deeds planned. Small deeds done are better love than great deeds planned. You would rather do something small today towards your vision than talk so big about it. There are people who do great things just in the mind. We are saying do it literally. Small deeds done are better love than great deeds planned. You would rather lack a strategic plan or a business plan, but do something literally. What do I mean? If you want to write a book, write the first paragraph. It's better than talking so much about how you want to write. Small deeds done are better love than great deeds planned. It's easier to stay in action than to start an action. It is easier to stay in action than to start an action. Every time you're starting something new, be it a business, be it a ministry, be it a school you want to start, things are so great. Once you get started, it's easy to flow. Beginning is halfway done. For those of you who put up their own homes, they know you only need to put up the foundation stone and the rest just follows. But if you sit down until everything is clear about an apartment you want to put, you'll never put. You'll be shocked how resources follow the very first step of faith. Beginning is halfway done. Great things are accomplished through tiny moves, but nothing is accomplished by standing still. You want to go back to school? Go register now. Go check what they are offering. Great things are accomplished through tiny moves, but nothing is accomplished by standing still. Be not afraid of moving slowly. Be afraid of standing still. Be not afraid of moving slowly. Be afraid of standing still. The last statement I gave you, what I am to be, I am busy becoming right now by the choices I am making. What I am to be, I am busy becoming right now by the choices I am making. I'll never be a millionaire. I am busy becoming a millionaire right now by the choices I am making. I'll never be a kingdom influencer. I'm busy becoming a kingdom influencer right now by the choices I am making. You don't become, you are busy becoming. Now, the language of tomorrow belongs to Satan. The scripture teaches us now is the hour of salvation. Today is the day of salvation. The language of the God we serve is the language of now, the language of today. Procrastination aborts vision. It steals away your dreams. Don't postpone this thing. James says, don't just be hearers of the word, but be ye doers. Don't postpone this message. Identify what you want in the course of this message, so that when you are praying, you are specific. You are praying for this specific business. Number four, comparisons. The fourth thing that kills our dreams, for comparisons. There was a Tanzanian athlete who was scheduled for marathon in Mexico. During the race, he hurt his leg so badly that he couldn't run. About 4 hours later, he dragged his way to the finishing line. The journalist went over to him and asked him, how come you kept on running 4 hours after the medals were already awarded? He looked straight into the eyes of the reporters and said, excuse me, gentlemen and ladies, when my country sent me to this country and paid the air ticket, they never sent me here to compare myself with the other athletes. They sent me here to finish the race. 1 Timothy 4:7. I have fought the good fight of faith. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me that crown of righteousness, which the good Lord will give to me, and not only to me, but to all those who look forward to his glorious appearance. And the Apostle Timothy brings out a strong message. There's a race set for each one of us. Some of us, the major reason we don't progress, we are distracted by what the other sister is doing. So when she buys a car, you deviate the business money and look for a car to show how you're still around. And you have no clue where she got the money for the car. We are in serious comparisons. You hear somebody has gone to Brazil to watch football. You have no clue whether he was sponsored. You take a fright by selling some lard. We need to come back to this reality. In life, there will always be someone ahead of you. There will always be someone behind you. Stop competing. In any case, even if you reach where they have reached, who told you that is God's expectations for you? You might be far below God's expectation for you. You have to compete to complete your race. Stop running on the fast track. Run on your track. Finish your race. Compete against your maximum potential. Do everything humanly possible to make the statement that I only see Jesus and Paul saying. Jesus was able to say in John 17:3 that I finished the work that you gave me. Paul is able to say that statement that I have finished the work, Lord, you gave me. Will you be able to say that? How can you finish a work, a task that you do not know in the first place? Is that possible? So you must know your race for you to finish your race. This is very common, sisters. To compare yourself because you're single with a classmate you had in college or in high school who's married, that's her race. Run your race. And who told you she's smiling all the way in her marriage? Run your race. Who gave a certain age in which we should get babies or get married? Is the Bible written at what age we should get married? Is the Bible written on how expensive a wedding should be? Did you know the Bible describes marriage but not wedding? So if you choose two people and you call pastor to bless you, that's a wedding. You don't need this congregation for it to be a wedding. You only need covenants that can be honored. Run your race. Why am I saying this? In this great city of Nairobi, we have bigger vehicles than they are there in France, than they are there in Germany. There are more Mercedes in Nairobi than in Germany on the roads. I don't know whether you know this. Some of you know what I'm saying is true. There is too much competition here. Please run your race. Number five, discouraging remarks. Discouraging remarks. Your stepmother said, you will never make it. And you believed the report. Your ex said, you'll amount to nothing. And you believed the report. Your father left you when you were young. He never blessed you. He never paid your fees. By God's grace, you managed. I'll tell you something, sisters. You expect your best friends, your family, your parents to encourage you, to inspire, to invigorate, to motivate, to pat your back. Unfortunately, the exact opposite happens in the reality of life. Those you trusted the most will betray you. They'll steal your husband. Oh, I wish I didn't say that. But this happened with Christ, betrayed by one of the 12. You will be betrayed by someone you trusted. You'll be shocked by their conduct. What must you do? I have some suggestion for us. Losers will blame their past. They'll blame their parents. They'll blame their husbands. They'll blame the country. They'll blame the government. They'll blame anything but themselves. Winners, on the other hand, will take responsibility for their destiny. A winner will always argue, if it is up to me, it is up to me. I'm the only reason for my success, and by default, I'm the only reason for my failures. I take responsibility for my progress. I take liabilities for my shortcomings. I am liable for my mistakes. Losers will always look at discouraging remarks as stepping stones. Winners will look at them as stepping stones. My message for the queens, if anyone makes a discouraging remark about the business you want to do, the career you are pursuing, relationships you are engaged in, turn it around. Make it the driving force why you must make it, to prove them wrong. Turn every discouragement into a motivation. Turn every curse into a blessing, to prove their prophecies, prophecies of doom. Do not allow them to confirm their prophecies in your life. You are blessed, and no one can stop it. You only have to trust God's report. Every discouragement must be the driving force why you must make it, to prove it wrong. So if someone says you'll not do it in that venture, make sure that's the biggest motivation why you must pursue it. You are unstoppable. Do not allow anyone to define what you can from what you can't do, be or never become. Only you can stop your dream. No one can. Our Father is in agreement with you. No one can stop you. You are dynamite. Did you know Psalms 82 verse 6 says you are God's? You are sons of the Most High God. You have the power to create wealth. Nothing and no one can stop you except you. Number six, why are we not reaching there? Number six, past success. Past success. Let me say this. One of the challenges I find in the church, we get satisfied with our last achievement. I'll call six people at random. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All of you, just come. Let's be practical here. I want to find your last success. Come, the six of you. I'll ask you very simple questions in different areas, all right? No, just come. Believe me, pastor can tell you, I never bite. I'll start with one line. Are you employed? Yes. You're working in what position?
Operations.
For how long have you been in operations?
7 years.
7 years. You need repentance. You must be progressive from now. You know what happened? What's your name?
Evelyn.
Evelyn, you got a senior positions. you are head of operations. Without your knowledge, you got satisfied. What's your name? When is the last time you were in school?
204.
And this is 2014, 10 years, you need repentance. Oh, you got satisfied with the last degree. That's not your potential. No, I just want to check our past successes. All right, look at my eyes. Are you dating? Are you married? You're single. Have you ever dated someone? Then you believe that men are bad. Do you date anymore? No. Yes. You are dwelling on the past. Men are good. They were created by God. Give me a high five. The past relationship should not determine your future relationships. Amen. Ah. How are you, sister? By the way, this is not word of wisdom, all right? No. I'm not talking about word of wisdom here. We are just discussing, all right? What is your last success in your own words?
I got promoted to an assistant manager 1 month ago.
Wow, 1 month ago you became an assistant manager. No quarrel with you, fantastic. Give me a high five. Keep moving on. Which is your last success?
Okay, I opened my business last year.
You opened your business last year. Which business?
Okay, I do clothing.
Clothing. Where did you open it?
In Thika.
In Thika. Uh-huh. Last year. What are you doing? Be specific. What about clothing?
I make all types of clothes. Now I'm specializing in t-shirts and tracksuits.
How are you distributing your clothes?
Okay, I take them to companies and schools.
Wow, give me a high five. What are you doing with yourself?
I'm a business development manager.
Wow. So you are a consultant. Are you working for a company? Where?
In town.
In town. A corporate. It's a circle. You've been in that position for how long?
For 3 months.
3 months. No quarrel with you. The last three girls. This is my message. Don't dwell on your past. Let me say something before you sit down. After preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, 1,500 square miles all over Europe and Asia Minor, the entire known world, with no single car to move, with no single airplane to fly, with no single computer to help him write. After such a huge accomplishment, after such a huge successful story, the Apostle Paul said that, I quote, in Philippians 3:13 and 14, I do not count myself to have apprehended, or rather to have gotten hold of it. One thing I do, I forget the past, and I add the word success, and I press on to the mark. I press on to that mark. I'll not keep talking about how I went to Asia Minor, how I went to Rome, how I went to Jerusalem. Yes, I have fought the beast before, but I keep that behind me, and I press forward. We can't keep on the past. You know, some ladies, after they get married, they stop thinking. Because all they wanted is a husband. And that's why single ladies like you achieve more than married dudes. Let me tell you, I'm serious with you. Most single girls achieve more than married women. Married women become a shadow of their husbands. Yet the pastor told us, the virtuous woman, the husband is the shadow of the virtuous woman. But most married women in Kenya, I don't know about Nigeria, but here in Kenya, they are shadows. We only see single ladies shining. Single ladies, stand up. Single ladies, I have a message for you now. Hear this. We're going to give you a message right now. In life, you must always look, two messages. You must always look at what you have, not what you do not have. There is something you have that the married people don't have. You have the time and no one is questioning it. You can go and train in Kigali without questions. Look at what you have, not what you do not have. But I have a warning for you. Don't fight marriage. Don't speak against husbands. You can't get what you speak against. Just realize you don't have him. You make use of that fact that he's not there. We get very demanding. I've been married for 11 and a half years. We can be very demanding. So right now when you're single, maximize that opportunity. But don't speak against marriage. Don't even be in that company of people who speak against marriage. But just be on the move. Do not stop buying a house simply because you're waiting for a man to buy a house. What's wrong with having three houses? Our vice president has a house somewhere in Eldoret, a very beautiful one. He has a house here in Karen. He has a vice president's one in Karen. It's okay to have 10 houses. Go ahead and build your house. Don't wait for a husband. You may be seated. Thank you. Thank you. Number 7, past mistakes. Number 7, past mistakes. I want to ask you, queens, Queen Esther generation, and I want some people here to be honest. We are in church. I want you to be honest. How many listening to me in this live audience have ever started a business but it closed down for one reason or another? You started a business but it closed down. Let me see. Hands up. Wow, goodness, too many. Let me have 5 volunteers. Just 5. Don't shy. No, 5 volunteers. I saw so many hands. Don't shy. We are talking about point number 7, past mistakes. Let me have 3 more. Good, very good. Thank you. Thank you. Wow, this is beautiful. Okay, that's enough. Now, I'm going to ask you just a few questions. You just answer the questions, all right? What business were you doing?
Export of oranges, fruits.
Where were you exporting to? Come nearer.
I was taking them to African countries.
African countries. You're buying them here? From Egypt?
Yeah, and relocate to anybody who needs.
No. Give me the countries you're exporting to. Let's be specific.
Tanzania.
Tanzania. Were you taking oranges there?
Yes.
Okay, 2 questions for you. Do Tanzanians eat oranges today?
Yes, they do.
Okay, very good. Wow. So the export business works, and the Tanzanian market is still ripe for oranges. So you agree with me? Are there people selling oranges to Tanzania?
Yes.
So it's not about the business. It's not about the market. It's about you.
Yes.
Good. What business were you doing?
I failed twice, actually, but I have succeeded once.
I want the business you failed. Which one was that?
Business process outsourcing and keeping chicken.
Which one do you want to discuss about? Okay. What is that all about? What is BPO? Some people here have no idea what is BPO. Okay, talk about the chicken business. Where were you keeping chicken?
In Mombasa.
Mombasa. Where were you selling?
To the hotels.
In Mombasa. 2 questions for you. Are chickens sold in hotels in Mombasa?
Many.
Oh, they still eat chicken. Oh. So the business of chicken works in Mombasa hotels?
Yes.
So it's about you. What happened?
I was not very careful in the marketing.
You are not careful with marketing. What happened with the export?
Okay, there were challenges when Egypt started having...
Not Egypt. Are Tanzanians eating oranges? So what happened?
I guess business management.
Business management. You know what I want us to do? Intrinsic analysis, not external analysis. You know, it's very easy to blame everything. Are you with me? The Kenyan market, the Egypt market, the what. Unless you convince me, there are no oranges in Egypt and there are no oranges eaten in Tanzania. Come. What business were you doing?
I was selling shoes.
Shoes, where?
Masai shoes in my office where I used to work.
You are selling to your colleagues at work. Now they walk barefoot, isn't it?
No.
So they still wear shoes? Oh, so they are still in need of shoes.
Yes, they are.
So where did you go wrong because they are still wearing shoes?
They referred me to several clients, but I was lazy. I couldn't wake up in the morning.
You were lazy. Wow. We start prayers now. Thank you for the confession. What business were you doing?
I started a fashion school and a fashion designing shop.
Just a minute. Let's start with the school. Is there a fashion where?
I started in Lusaka. I relocated to Nairobi. It failed.
There are no fashion schools in Lusaka today. Is that the case?
Mine was the second.
Yours was the second. But then they say in marketing is about the one who shouts loudest and earliest. So you had the best opportunity. So what happened?
We relocated to Kenya. I started again. It didn't just pick up.
So what is the issue? You were not consistent.
I think so.
Because you left it not ripe and then you came to Nairobi. All right. What business were you doing?
Roofing tile distributor.
Sorry?
Roofing tile distributor.
Where?
In Nairobi.
Oh, in Nairobi, buildings do not have tiles again. Do they still have tiles? So people still sell tiles in Nairobi. So it's about you. Where did you go wrong?
I blamed the competition. I wasn't aggressive enough.
Are you you saying there's only one supplier now? So there's still competition. So where did you go wrong? You're not aggressive enough. All right. What business were you doing?
Hotel business.
Hotel business. Amazing. You had a hotel? Where?
In Bondo.
Bondo. Oh, there are no hotels in Bondo today. They're still there. So where did you go wrong?
I had a challenge in my health, so I had to come back to Nairobi, so I decided not to go back.
Good. Because hotels still work in Bondo. All right. What are you doing?
I'm selling clothes in Eldoret.
How are you selling them? Hooking in a shop or what?
It's in a shop.
Where were you getting them from?
From here in Nairobi.
From Nairobi to Eldoret. And suddenly people in LD no longer wear clothes.
They do.
So where did you go wrong?
I'm thinking the choice of the person I employed, because I'm fully employed here in Nairobi.
So you didn't give it time. You delegated. All right. And maybe the person you delegated to was selling her own clothes.
I think the problem is the dedication that the person had, and maybe there were differences in objectives. I think, I decided to open a different business here in Nairobi and put my employer, the people I employ, down, sit down with them so that I can give them the objectives that I have so that we can move together.
My sister, what business were you doing?
I opened a clothing shop.
So many clothes. How, in a very small sample, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. How many are doing clothes? Let me see again. 1, 2, 3. 3 out of 8. What percent is 3? That 3 out of 8. Almost half, eh? Like 40%. Where?
In Zimmerman.
Zimmerman. In a shop?
Yes.
And your customers were from the area? Do they still wear clothes? So it's about you. Of course, I like that. So where did you go wrong?
I chose the wrong place because I live in Rongai, and commuting to Zimmerman was a challenge. It was beginning, so I didn't have the operating capital to move to and from.
My message is this, my sisters. You cannot turn back the hands of time. Yesterday is gone. The future is like a blank screen. You script on it what so you desire. Dust off. Stand up. Move on. Don't think about the past mistakes. Address them internally. Don't address them externally. Where did I go wrong? So that I don't repeat the same mistake. But don't dwell there. Don't have a pity party for 2 years. It's okay to have a pity party for a day. But move on. Stand up and move on. Everyone who succeeded in business had a degree of failure, had a place of mishap. They had some areas that took them back, but they didn't dwell there. They stood up, dusted off, and moved on. But don't analyze that challenge externally. As long as you don't realize you are the cause, you will not be able to address that. You may be seated. Thank you so much. Thank you. Number 8, environment. Are you aware of what we are trying to do? We are trying to check why we are not tapping into the infinite source. That despite God giving us all this, why are we not getting it? Number 8, environment. I'll ask you for a favor, if you don't mind. Please write for me your 3 best friends. And don't write your spouse. Don't write your daughter, your son, your brother, your sister, your mother, your uncle. Don't write a relative. Who are your 3 best friends? Someone you can give a ring. I need 100,000 right now. And you don't sign anywhere. And they said you. You love the company of this lady. Who are your 3 best friends? Please, just write for me. Don't get tired. Who are your closest friends? They may not be in the choir, so don't show them the list. Who are your 3 best friends? Look at that list carefully. That's your character. If you don't like it, it's time to move on. If there are some dudes in that list you don't like, they were meant for a season. And the season is over. Please let go and move on. You are the main actor in your story. You must learn somebody's role when it ends in your story. And learn to let go and move on. You might have outgrown some relationships. And as soon as you hold them on, you will remain there. You are an average of your friends. Your performance is the average of the people around you. Let me say this. You cannot outperform your clique. Your level of association will determine your destiny. Let me say it one more time. Your level of association will determine your destiny. Can I ask you a simple question? Let's talk about soda, Coca-Cola. What is the cost of Coca-Cola? Let's say at the Stanley. Somebody, Stanley ground floor, because they have different prices. Ground floor and up floor. Somebody who is sure, not guesswork. What's the price of Coke? They normally sell 300 millimeters. How much is the price at the Stanley? I don't want guesswork. What is the cost of that soda, the small soda? What is the cost of soda at the Stanley? Yeah. 150. Good. Thank you. I wonder someone who is sure. 150. What is the price of that soda here where we are? In the kiosks in the estates? 25. Now look at this. That soda is sold at 19 shillings 50 cents at wholesale price. So it's sold in the kiosk in the estate where you live at 25 bob. The Stanley does not cook sodas. They sell at 150. What is the difference? Business location, environment. I would rather pay more rent at upmarket and have between 150 and 20 bob, the cost being roughly 20, the difference they make is 130. I would rather look for rent upmarket rather than continue collecting kobole. You know, at a kiosk. 100 people are only giving you 500 bob because of the choice of your location. Did you realize whenever God called people, the first thing he did is to relocate them? He tells Abraham, you know what, Abraham? I have something I want to do with you, but there are two problems. First, I'm going to change your name. Number two, I have to change your locality. There are people around you who don't believe in you. Your grandfather, your mother, your father, you cannot succeed in this locality. You're going to move. Believe me, some of you listening to me here, with all due respect, you need to physically relocate. You need to get a house somewhere else. You are in a neighborhood that is suffocating your progress. You can't even breathe properly. You know, there are some environments you go and they just kill your dream. Let me tell you, I have launched all my books at the Serena. Let me give you an example. When I launched my last book, The Formation of a County Government in Kenya. Well, we paid slightly more at the Serena. But that night, and I think my secretary is with us here, she can confirm, that same night, the people who bought the books took care of the hotel. We invited 150 people. We got 270 people. And everybody who turned up was buying 2-3 books. The difference was the locality. I could have chosen to pick Karumaido Hotel at Kariokor. At Kariokor. So that I pay some accommodation of 2,000. But everyone who comes there, they're expecting me to buy their food and buy for them books. You know, they are so mannerless. Please, don't go take tea at Karumaido. Relocate. Make your coffee join like KBC and Java. Start interacting with serious queens. You know, some places are not for queens. Sindio, some places are not for queens. No. I'll tell you something else, and don't take offense. You'd rather have 3 good outfits, but they are good outfits. But then I could go to the baobao kwa streets. Baobao. No. Dress like a queen. It is true. There are some sisters here. Their appearance alone to the governor's office wanafuguliwa mlango. Others, they are security threat. They start wondering, is this the person who was throwing bombs at Mpeketoni? Just by your dressing. Everybody is fearing. The governor has to be kept in safety. You know, I'm doing a lot of consultancies for State House. I've been doing that for 5 years. And believe me, if you are not sharp, they will not open for you the gates. They start searching even with dogs under your car. They are fearing. There are joints that are not for queens. Your environment, believe it or not, friends, determines how far you go in your dream. Your level of association determines your destiny. You cannot outperform the clique of your association. Please, don't be offended to walk out from some relationships. You have outgrown them. Move on. Even the Lord Jesus, when he called the apostles, he separated them from their past, from their past friendships, for them to be able to be fishers of men. Had they continued to live with fishermen, they would have just thought like fish, smelled like fish, behaved like fish. Number 9, traditions. Traditions. Unajua hapa kwetu kabani. Hai, hata hakunaga kajura kwetu. What are you talking about? You're telling me to be a senator. Hakuna. Hai, our blood. They become a statistician. Kwetu hatuko tunaroa hesabu. There is something wrong in our family. No one has ever tried even a matatu. And you're telling me to own an airline. These things are not ours. There's a certain lady, I'll not mention her name. She was our Christian Union secretary when I was doing my undergrad. And she became pregnant after college. In my college days, we knew her as the role model. Holy, at any ago you look at her. The epitome of righteousness. The SI unit of holiness. She got pregnant after college. Some brothers could not wait. They went to her sister. What happened? What happened? She said, you know, in my family, all my sisters get babies before they get married. Traditions. In my family, in my clan. You know, there are some people here who are believers in Christ, washed by the blood. But when it comes to some rituals like burials, you wonder whether they are Christians. Is that a fact? Yes, some of those who answered yes still name their children with the traditional names. Najua kwetu kwa Kikuyu, lazima niite mami, lazima niite baba, even when the father's name is Wajohi, a drunkard. These are still traditions. There's a challenge for us. There are some traditions that will limit us from progressing. How many here are doing farming business? Okay, come, the two of you. Three. Good, I've seen three hands. Just come. You're doing farming business. Just come, the three of you. Let me just establish something. All right. You're in farming business. Just come nearer. What business are you doing?
I plant mbogas, vegetables.
Where?
In Ruaka.
Ruaka. What type of mbogas?
Mtoo and sageti, this kienyeji.
Thank you. What business? What farming business?
I do construction, supply and delivery of construction materials.
Wow, give me a high five. You're doing delivery of construction materials? Okay. You're doing farming business? What?
I farm sukuma wiki vegetables and pumpkins and crops like maize.
Where do you plant maize?
The site of Kabete.
You're planting maize at Kabete? Okay. What can stop you from having a harvest this year?
Nothing.
What factors can determine your success or not?
What factors can determine rain, water?
Good. Let's stop there. Rain. Let's just look at this. In her own confession, rain can stop her harvest this year. Let me ask you a question. How many here know that Egypt is in the middle of the Sahara? How many know that? You know that. How many know there's no rain, proper rain in Saudi Arabia? Is that a fact? So how come there's no famine in Egypt? Irrigation, correct? And did you know they were doing irrigation 2,000 years before our Lord and Savior was born? You are aware of that. But my sister is still waiting for rains. The year 2014. How many here have heard of Amiran Company? Amiran. Maybe some sisters here are there. At 150, they give you a greenhouse. You pay after you sell the harvest. And you stop interceding for rain, you start interceding for souls. By stopping to do business the traditional way. Number 10 and the last one. Thank you. You may sit. Number 10 and the last one. Negative words. Negative words. May I say this? You cannot get what you speak against. You cannot grow beyond your words. Words are the best indicator of your thought system. The Lord Jesus taught, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Proverbs 18:21, life and death is in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruits thereof. If you speak against wealth, you will not get wealth. If you speak against health, you will not get good health. There is power in the words you speak. Words have the power to bless and the power to curse. Born blind, deaf, and dumb, when she finally learned to speak, Helen Keller said it so eloquently. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will break my heart. And I want to admonish us, student of God, confess what you want to see in your business and start confessing it right now. Say, I am a winner. I am born to lead. I'm born to succeed. Speak about that business in advance, that I'm the head of an airline industry. I'm going to buy a train to be carrying people when they finish the standard rail gauge. I'm going to bring one of the trains and operate it in there. I'm going to do something parallel to the Kenya Post Office and deliver letters to homes. It's a tall order, but then you serve a tall God. You serve a big God. Start thinking about what you're discussing. I like the lady who said she's doing supplies of construction industries. I mean, I have seen Upper Hill for the last 4 years. They have not completed the road. We should be getting a sister here who is very upset with that trend and say, I'm going to register a construction company and ensure that I'm going to do things right for this country. Chinese are getting it right, but then the money is going out of the country simply because you and me have the spirit of mediocrity. There is so much average in our economy, and I guarantee you, the moment you go an extra mile, you'll have a breakthrough. Speak positive words. Don't speak anything negative about what you're doing. The next time someone asks you, how are you doing? Don't speak like the Indians do. Not bad, not bad. No! Super fine! I'm flying high! You see, I'm an eagle. I'm a queen. I'm building a palace, man. Things are great in here. Because those words become a reality as you continue to speak them about. I've done a little book called The Power of the Spoken Word. I've written a lot about how you should speak and how you should speak against a past that was spoken to you. Those books are available right there, and you can pick a copy at only 500 bob. And I'll also request you to follow me on my blogs, kenyajuinganga.com. I've been posting those blogs. Many of you are following me. I'll be blessed to share more with you, kenyajuinganga.com. Thank you so much. Let's welcome man of God, Pastor Esther.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Is that all you can do? We must have to celebrate our own. Africans, we have to learn how to celebrate our own. When the man of God was speaking and he says, what you criticize, you will never get. That's a serious matter. Some of you will see people prospering rather than rejoice with them. You stay by the corner criticizing them, scrutinizing them, trying to know whether they are using magic. If they are using magic, you should be the magician. What you criticize, you will never experience. I was talking with my senior sister this afternoon, and we were talking about something, and I told her, you know what? I said, people who learn how to appreciate people and celebrate other people's victory should thank God for that grace, because majority are bitter with other people's progress. We were talking just this evening, and I told her, I said, you know what? If God has given us that grace, because last night, the three of us, the three daughters, we are talking so much about what God is doing. There is a woman that taught me in school that was my teacher for religious studies that they say is making a wave in Nigeria now, a serious wave. And they gave me her birthday. She has a ministry like Queen Esther's Generation called Sisters Fellowship. Her birthday is coming up 5th of July. Come and see the cards. I'm told the women have made 5 different uniforms to wear every day and celebrate her birthday for 5 days. They showed me the card yesterday. Every day has a uniform. Those women built her a house. She has built a serious school, one of the best in our places. And we were talking about this woman. When this woman was teaching me religious study, this sister's fellowship, I started it with her. My sisters know. I was a student. I came out, I finished. I now got born again in the campus. I came back to her because she's born again. And she would send me for evangelism. And she would be kneeling down praying as I go to witness to people. She would tell me, Nkem, you go. You will meet me praying. She was my teacher in secondary school. But when I left secondary school, went to the campus, I got born again in the campus. Then I came back because she has always been born again. And we became friends. This woman will go on her knees and will send me out on evangelism. Because that time, I had a very special gift. There is this gift I had that time. Many men were competing for me. So it was easy to bring them to Christ. They were cheap, cheap commodities for Jesus Christ. In fact, my senior sister is here. She will tell you, there is one she was telling me she traveled together with last week. When she came to collect get American Embassy visa, and she was going back, she said, you know who I saw? That one used to tell them, if I don't marry your sister, I will die. So she boarded the same bus with that one. And now that one has bought his own house, she was telling me. And so we were discussing yesterday, this woman of God called Mumin Chess, now in Nigeria, was my teacher. And that time she would tell me, there was a particular time she sent me out to minister to one married man. Because that married man was working where I was working, doing my industrial attachment like intern. And this man was on my neck that whatever I want, he will do to divorce the wife to marry me. And this Mumin Chess, I didn't know that the wife of that man was so close to Mumin Chess. So when I told Mumin Chess, he said, you are the one that will bring him to Christ. What we are going to do, we will state manage everything. So we pretended that I should visit his house to look for the wife. And the Mumin Chess will be praying for me as I go. So I went. Mumin Chess was on her knees. I left her house. I got to this man's house, knocked. I came in. The wife, we had planned it with the wife. I came in, the wife pretended that, oh, how are you? I said, fine. She said, may I help you? I said, okay. My manager, I was just looking for my manager because there is something I'm looking for. And I passed this way and I say, it's like it's their house. She said, come in. I came in. She said, what can I offer you? I said, Fanta. She brought Fanta. Then the manager, the husband came out. Oh, Nkem, how are you? I said, fine. I said, this is your wife. He said, yes, all of your association born again. I said, So your wife is born again. He said, That is all of you are in the same category. But anyway, have your seat. I had my seat. The wife now say, I want to go. I'm going somewhere. We had planned that the wife should excuse us. And the wife left. Within 5 minutes, that man was on his knees and I led him to Christ. And after I led him to Christ, he called the wife. And the wife came. We agreed on the time the wife will come back. And they took me to the master bedroom. The wife has not entered for about 2 years. The wife used to sleep in the sitting room and other places. And Mumin Chess knew all those stories about that woman. Apparently, the man was occultic and chased away the wife. Many times, they've planned to kill the wife in the occultism. But whenever they call the wife's name, a rock will appear on the mirror. Eventually, we organized with Mumin Chess. People from Full Gospel Businessmen Fellowship came and carried everything from that master bedroom and burnt it with fire. You see how many years that woman started? Today, she's making a wave in Nigeria. And I'm told what women are doing for her. They were telling me, you'd better not cross. You cross Mumin Chess' way. Women in Onitsha will carry you on their head and beat hit you thoroughly. Because God has used that to change their lives. We are just talking about rejoicing with others. But my senior sister was now telling me how one woman made a sarcastic statement. When that woman was to appear in a magazine for something, my sister was the editor. And somebody came and said, she will not appear in that magazine. And they were asking why. Just jealousy. And the Bible says envy is the rottenness of the bone. You see, people who are envious, they never look good. Even if you put all the pedicure and all the manicure, their faces are squeezed with wrinkles. Why? Because they never rejoice with others. The right attitude in life is to associate with those that are succeeding. When you see people who are doing well, go and hold their hands. Because fire begets fire. When you associate with the president, you wouldn't know when you become a president of an organization. So today we have had it in a way that you will go home. My brother, you were not here when I told them that the Lord told me that salary will not take us far. God told me 2 months ago as I was preparing for Kesha and I was to preach, God told me, tell the people, anybody that is earning salary and that's what you are living for, will never experience overflowing blessing. And yesterday I told them that. And I said, when I was preparing the sermon, I asked God, what about me? Is even you the preacher? I was talking with my sister, Reverend Hope, on the radio at the interval of a short break. And we are talking about NIV, how it talks about Ruth. That when Ruth followed Naomi, she wasn't following to get husband. She followed to serve. Then NIV says, it turned out that the day she went to serve in the field, the particular field she entered became Boaz's field. So NIV say it turned out. In other words, as she decided to walk, to serve, to go and do diligent work, God orchestrated his fate and make sure that she did not land in the field of a poor man. Destiny. But you've got to walk. Some people who think that ministry is for dropouts, change your mind. I was telling you just a few days ago, I don't know how many hours I've slept. My sisters have been saying, is it the way you live your life? I say yes. You come in early morning, you're out. You have study to do in the night to prepare for a good message. You have time to intercede. You have time to listen to people. There are people making demands and sending you some useless text messages to explain. And they expect you to answer them. And you don't answer them. They are angry that you are arrogant. They don't know what you are doing at the midnight. You need to walk. Finally, you have heard from me many times that a Nigerian woman is now the richest black woman on earth. She overtook Oprah Winfrey. Oprah Winfrey was the black richest woman on earth. Today, Mrs. Alakija is the richest woman on earth. Born in the family of 54 children. And her mother was the first wife, hated by the father. It was by default that she was asked to escort the child of the wife, the mother, the father loved, to England. By default, they didn't find anybody to escort that one. So the father said, you escort. So when she got there, she went into fashion designing in London. No, she studied and came back and became a secretary in banks. Then one day she said, I've been sitting on one position. People will come into the bank. become my boss. Meanwhile, I've been in this bank for 5 years. But because I don't have certificate as a degree holder, everybody is commanding me in the office. I am secretary of everybody. She resigned and went to learn fashion designing in London. Finished, came back, started sewing clothes in Nigeria. From there, she got connected to the late wife of our former president, Miriam Babangida, the most fashionable first lady we've ever had in Nigeria. When she comes out, you see beauty, beauty. And if you just say, Jesus, you created human beings. Her fashion was unbeatable. You can't beat Miriam. When she was our first lady's whenever she was going anywhere, we come to watch TV, not to hear what she was saying, but how she has dressed. She started making cloth for her. When you start making cloth for the first lady, what will happen? Miriam Babangida connected her to the husband, and that is how she got connected to drilling oil in Nigeria. Went into printing. But the greatest thing about her, when I watch her on YouTube in London, when she was honored in London, I watched the YouTube. As soon as she was called up, she took the mic. The first thing she did was, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And she said, I am who I am because of Jesus Christ. And before she gave her speech, she asked, how many of you here in this conference is born again? He said, if you are born again, lift up your hand. In a meeting where the world invited her, why will she not ask that question? Are you giving her food? Are you paying her rent? People take offense at you when you are non-entity. Come and see the women that escorted her for that prize day. All of them were timbers and calibers. When she stood, she was introducing them. Say, I came with this. I looked at those women. I looked at this. I looked at this. Let me tell you, we have decided one way or the other, we are bringing her to QEG. One way or the other. Ask Pastor Neck, where is Anne? Oh, Anne, okay, I've not seen her. Pastor Neck, we talked about it and we are praying seriously and we are working towards it. Googling, looking for emails, for phone number, because we sat down and we said, if that woman gets connected to QEG, come to be doing empowerment for us as African women. Tomorrow it will be on the YouTube. A secretary, she just got her degree the other day. A secretary. Now they are rumoring that she's about to start a church. Why will there be no congregation there? Is she looking for your rent? Is she looking for tithe and offering? She will come to church and tell you, anyway, by the grace of God, God has given me this ministry to run. And this building is 10 billion, but I've paid for it. But in case you need God to bless you, you can buy whatever you think you want to buy. She has so many foundations. She has taking care of 2,000 orphans to graduate. She went to a particular family. One family took 5 children that are orphans, took all of them to school. They have all graduated. They are working. One family. You are talking about money. Whether you like it or not, after this meeting, there will be spiritual and economic relocation. Anybody that looks at me as a pastor, and you are looking at me and you are saying, why is pastor looking like this? Why is pastor driving a car? Why is pastor eating good food? You have grasshopper mentality. T.D. Jakes lives in an area in America that only him is the black man. That area is strictly reserved for the white. He is the only black man authorized to live there. And the media was after him to know the secret of his wealth. in one of our women meeting here, I gave you the story of how he bought a house. You remember? Only to discover that the house he bought has natural resources under. When he moved from Virginia to Dallas, God told him to move from Virginia to Dallas. As he was relocating, can you imagine a family, just a pastor's family, say, I want to leave Kenya to somewhere. 50 families closed down everything and relocated with him. They say, we can't leave you. So if you don't want to live in Virginia, you want to live in Dallas, we also go to Dallas. And these are billionaires. You wait until you hear my speech tomorrow. Then you know where we are heading to. I told you earlier that God has given me the team for convention of 2015. You will hear more tomorrow. Whether we like it or not, the Kenya women will teach the other women in Africa that there is a God that picks you from the dustbin and sets you in the palace. Thank you, man of God. God bless you. At this time, we want to quickly watch a drama before Reverend Hope takes the podium. Yesterday, I told you it's about Alabaster Box. After the meeting, they corrected me, said tomorrow is Alabaster Box. Then I remembered that tonight is a serious drama. Tomorrow is the few minutes Alabaster before she preaches. So at this time, I want to invite, are you ready? No, not you, the actresses and actors, are you ready? So I can step out. All right, they are ready. Just give them a round of applause as they come.
power has disconnected the electricity.
What? Oh my God, the units are over. What am I going to do? Don't worry, Angie, this will soon be over.
But I wanted to watch a TV program today.
Angie, please, today was not a good payday at work. Tomorrow we'll sort something out, okay?
Mom?
Yes?
Plus, I'm feeling hot, cold, I don't even know. I feel like I'm not feeling well.
Oh my God, your fever is high. I need to get you medicine.
Mom, if you leave right now, what time are we going to eat?
Angie, you did not eat in school.
I'm so hungry, no.
Why?
I arrived here at noon, and we were chased out of school, all of us students with big school fees balances.
Why? Angie, I think I talked to the teacher and I told him to give you time. I'm going to pay up. Now what is all this? What am I going to do? Let me check in my bag if I have some money. Oh, thank goodness. 10, 20, 50, 60, 100. Angie, let me go and get you medicine. Half bread.
Half bread?
Yes, Angie, at least I make black tea for you. We see.
Mom, black tea?
Angie, I'll be back after a short while. Now who is this? Oh, Njoroge, how are you?
I am not fine.
Njoroge, please, not yet.
The last time I was here, we agreed that when I come back, we should not even negotiate.
Njoroge, right now my baby is sick. Just give me time. I'm going to pay up the rent.
Can't you see I've been kind and patient to you, ready?
More than that, Mr. Njoroge, but right now, please understand, I've been fired from work. My child is sick. I have no food in my house. Give me time. I'm going to pay up.
Well, Mama Aji, you have not paid rent for the last 6 months, eh? Do you think I own any charity organization here? I'm on the Japan UN, UN, I'm a Red Cross. You have not paid electricity. You have not paid water. Who jari pa sewage? Who jari pa security? Yeah? Mama Aji, toka. Toka kwagu.
Njoroge, please. Have mercy.
Toka. Toka.
Njoroge, where will my child and I sleep? I'm a single mother who's trying to make ends meet. Njoroge, please.
Mama Aji, nimesema toka.
Njoroge.
Mama Aji, toka. Kama uwe. Tokona. Oka. Oka.
Njoroge,
please. Toa hizo vitu zote nje. Na muatoe hadi hawa, tokeni.
Njoroge, please.
Nimesema toka.
Please, hold me, Angie. Njoroge, please have mercy.
Mama Aji nasema.
My child is sick.
When I come back here with a padlock, hautapenda. Hautapenda, Mama Aji.
Njoroge, please.
Toka.
Mama. Mama, where is the angel? Angie, please, the angel will be here. Just cover yourself.
But you know, they just don't feel what you feel. Times are hard, but God is so good. He's never failed you, and He says He never will.
Song is now to read. say together, hands is on the way. Because help
is on my way.
So you don't have to worry, because
help is on my way.
Come on, stand and help me sing, help is on the way. His Majesty the King calls you to his palace so that you can dine with him. Now, wake up and go. All this will soon be over.
I hope we are not late for this function. You know what, Rachel? If you had not told me to come, I was just fine staying at home.
Hey, ever since your breakup with Michael, you've really hated socializing. You need to loosen up, girl.
Rachel, that's not the point. He was my sixth breakup on the verge of a wedding.
Hey, it's still not the end. You'll find love.
I'm just tired.
Hey, you don't have to be.
My friend. Hello, darling.
Oh, hi, dear.
Wow. How are you doing?
I'm fine.
You look like you are even a queen, not even like a queen.
Thanks, darling.
Queen Rachel.
Thanks.
Wow, nice to see you. Hello, Judy.
Hi, Daniel.
Oh, you were able to make it.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
How are you?
I'm good, too.
I'm also fine. Everything is so okay.
Well, I'm sorry for the breakup. You know, he was a good friend of mine.
Hey, Siri. Shh. Hey, Judy, please don't mind
It's
us.
Okay.
Hey, Siri, I thought you said this was an office function. I cannot see anyone. All I see is my friends with their friends. What's not happening?
Yeah, it's true. I said it was an office function. Mm-hmm. But for your own information, it's not an office function.
What do you mean?
I have a surprise for you.
A surprise?
Yes, of course, surprise.
Okay.
Wait a minute. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the moment we've all been waiting for. You see this queen, Rachel, standing before you. I have known her for the past 2 years. But today, the story of our love is beginning. Honey, without you standing by my side, my life would be incomplete. When I met you, I knew it that no woman will hold my heart so dear like you. When I saw you, I knew I have seen the mother of my children, my better half, and helpmate for me, the woman destined for me by God.
Aww.
Not until this moment, of which the result is in your hands. My dear, you deserve the very best. Someone who will back you up without limits, watch you grow without borders. And above all, love you endlessly.
Aww.
I hope you allow me to be the one.
Wow.
Sweetheart, I love you. What you're seeing here is not an office function.
It's not.
But I have chosen this day to invite your friends from near and far to make this moment I have longed for, a memorable one. I hope you make it a reality today. Sweetheart, will you be my wife?
Oh my God, Daniel.
Will you marry me?
Yes!
Come on.
Yes.
Yes. I'm mad at you.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
I'm the happiest man in the world.
Woo!
I'm so happy for you. I'm so, so happy for you.
Thank you.
Yes, I did. Oh, God.
Thank you,
thank you.
Give me that ring.
So, Judy, hi.
Oh, Sylvia, how are you?
I'm very fine.
It's been long.
I know.
I'm fine, too. And married. So, Judy, when are you planning to invite us for your engagement party?
She is right. I mean...
You know, as in, how old are you right now? Like, 37, 38, 40.
40.
I mean, when will you get the time to take care of children?
She is right. I mean, think about menopause. My dear, are you choosy on men?
I serve a living God. And my man will eventually come. My God is faithful.
Now, that's where the problem is. You see, you spend most of your time in church. You don't socialize. You don't go out.
I mean, your God needs to have mercy on you. I mean, you need more than a miracle. My friend, isn't it... Don't take this conversation personally, eh? But isn't it a shame that you're always the ever-faithful bridesmaid in all of your friends' weddings?
Sweetie, it's like this. You see, your last friend just got engaged. So that means you'll be the bridesmaid in her wedding.
She's right. I mean... None of your married friends will be bridesmaids in your wedding.
Ladies, please, just...
Oh, wait. I think I have an idea. I don't think you thought about this, but why don't you get a child? I mean, you get this done and over with. You're not getting any younger.
I mean, think about this, my dear. Think about it. Let it be food for thought, okay? My dear, let's go celebrate with Rachel.
Okay, sweetie, bye. And don't forget what we talked about. Sawa.
God, why is this happening to me? It hurts me so bad. God, what should I do? Hey, Rachel, we're going for the after party. Please, let's go. No, in fact, I have a phone call. Let me just pick it, then I'll be up with you shortly.
Please hurry up.
Okay.
Hello? Hello?
Hello, hello, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am?
Judy, it is 10 p.m. Where are you?
I'm at the Swiss Hotel. It was Rachel's engagement party, and I didn't know how time flew so fast.
Rachel?
Yes.
Rachel, your friend?
Yes, my
friend.
Your
one and only friend is getting married?
Yes, ma'am.
And my daughter here is still very single.
Ma'am, let's please not go through that.
Go through what, my daughter? Huh? Go through where? Do you realize that all my firstborns are married? Your brothers and sisters are in their homes, except you, my dear.
Ma'am, please.
Why are you so blind? Do you know how hard it is for me to see you like this? Huh? Judy, stop it. When will you get married and stop being the official ever faithful bridesmaid?
Mom.
You should even open a business. At least they'll pay you for your services. I'm sick and tired of your life. And I think you should too.
Hello? Hello? Oh, God. Why is this happening to me? It's so painful. It's so painful. Have you heard the mockery?
people with their commercials. The football should have started. What's so funny?
Gracie.
Who is Gracie?
Oh, sorry, Salome. Salome kuja.
Hapana we mistaki.
Salo. What is it? Kuja, what do you mean hapana?
Your wife will soon come home and she will catch us.
Leave alone my wife. You see, Grace.
Who is Grace? Sorry. Who is this Grace you're keeping on calling?
Sorry, Salo. You see? Salome. Come.
My wife will do it very fast. My wife will not know. Please come.
No.
Okay. Who have you been talking to?
What?
Yes.
No, I've not been talking to anyone. Why are you asking me that?
Because you have never said no. And you're only saying it today. Somebody's advising you.
No, sir. I'm just scared.
Scared of what? If it's my wife, she will never know unless you tell her. But what?
I need to tell you something else.
Yes, I'm listening.
If it is money, you know I give you more than what my wife can give you.
Not money.
Then what is it?
Salo?
This silence is not helping us. Just talk. Tell me what is wrong.
Okay, boss. I'm pregnant.
What? So you went out and cheated on me?
No. You're the one who took my innocence. This baby is yours.
Salome, you're not serious. My wife can't hear this.
So?
Leave.
I leave.
Just go, yes.
To where? Sir, to where? Where can I go? Sir, you said you love me.
Salome, this is not love. This is complicated. You don't understand. Just go. Go, Salome. Just go, please. But, you will bring...
But, sir, if you chase me away... No, my mother, she has no money. I am not able. If you send me out there, I will die. Don't send me away. Have mercy on me. Boss, please. Have mercy on me, guys.
It's okay. It's just... Hi. Salome. Oh, when did you find out you are?
It was on.
We need to figure out something. Talk.
I'm trying to.
What is going on here? Why are you holding my maid?
She's no, nothing. If yes, she's sick. You see.
I see. So you opted to hug her and rub her back, eh?
Madam, I can't. Hey.
You better not be sleeping with my husband.
Oh, take it easy. What did you do that for?
Sweetheart, that is how you deal with husband snatchers.
It has no time to... Hey! Stop it! Do you want to hurt her?
Why are you taking her side? Is there something going on here? Are you having an affair with my maid? Answer me, Mark!
No, she's pregnant.
What?
Yes.
Salome, is this true?
Madam, Sikwana!
Who is the father of your baby? Now you don't feel like talking, eh? Who is the father of your baby?
Hey, stop it! In case you want to know, yes, I'm the father.
What? Max, how could you do this to me? You, get out of my house.
Boss, where will I go?
She's not going anywhere.
Oh my God.
Yes! How can I be so stupid to just throw away the woman who have finally given me a child? You are joking.
Oh my God, no.
She's not going anywhere.
No, Max, no. No, Max.
You don't even know how it feels.
You don't know how it feels to be pregnant. You don't know. Imagine... She has given me a feeling that you have never given to me. 8 good years. She's not going anywhere. No.
Max, it's not my fault.
Apparently it is. See, I have been able to make another woman pregnant. It's your problem.
Max, we have been praying and trusting God for us to have a baby. Yet you go and defile our marriage with a maid. No wonder God is not answering our
correction. Prayers. Correction. Hallelujah. God has answered my prayers. You should continue praying. And number two, let me tell you, I don't care whether she is a maid. She has given me a child. And you should start respecting that. In fact, I have made a decision in this house. She is no longer a maid.
What?
Yes. And from now on, you will be sleeping in our bedroom.
Boss.
Yes. And you should pack to the guest room where you will be making those your continuous, endless, fruitless prayers. At least you have some time.
Max,
yes.
Has it come to this? What about all the love that we shared? Are you going to throw it away because of this cheap stupid maid?
I want you not to beat her several times, but useless. What is you? What's wrong with you? Huh? Do you want to kill her? Do you want her to miscarry my baby? What? In fact, I don't blame you. I don't blame you. You don't know how it feels like to be pregnant. Have you ever mothered a child? Look at you. I wonder why they even called you Eve. They should have called you Steve. Because I know I was sleeping with a man with womanly features. Oh, my sweetheart. See. Oh. Let me take you. Sorry. Let me take you to the hospital. Maybe she did something to you. And when I come back, let me warn you. You should have packed your things. Nonsense. Let's go.
Oh my God.
Oh, sorry.
All I ever wanted was a baby. God. I want a child of my own. God, please, take me out of this humiliation. Answer me the way you answered Hannah.
To you. Yeah.
go get to bed.
The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell in it. For he has formed it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Who shall ascend into his holy hill? Who shall stand in his holy place? He that has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul into vanity or sworn deceitfully. He shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation that seek him, they that seek his face, O Jacob. Lift up your head, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in.